Hey everyone, Robin here from Post Professionals. In this video, you'll learn in deep detail everything you need to know about Apple's 29th free update for Final Cut Pro 10 Motion and Compressor. An update aimed to make video post-production workflows even more flexible and easier. There's really a lot to talk about, which is why this has actually turned out to be so unexpectedly long. What's new and what I'll be talking about in detail is an expanded proxy workflow, new tools for social media, new audio-only crossfades, VR video, 3D model import in Motion, and much more. And at this point, I would also like to remind everyone to watch my video on how to update Final Cut Pro safely. And yes, before you update, probably your best bet. Link up here in the info card and in the description. Also, feel free to roam the channel and pick up even more useful information surrounding Final Cut Pro 10, since that is ultimately what this channel is all about. So, Final Cut version 10.4.9 isn't the huge update that I think many expected, but it's anything but a disappointment in my opinion. And if you're just interested in a specific topic or feature, you can jump from section to section here in the play bar, and there's also a clickable index in the description. Because, this is by far the longest free update video I've made so far, but nonetheless, hope that you find it as informative and useful as always. And should I have actually missed an important feature, or maybe you have praise, criticism, or even just a question, let me know down in the comments, hitting the thumbs up, subscription button, and or little bell dingus to not miss future updates is also very much appreciated and really helps the channel. But enough of all that, let's dive into all the update goodness. So to start things off, I want to talk about the brand new proxy media management, something I know that I've been waiting for a long time and have requested many times, so it's great to see that Apple is listening. While Final Cut Pro's proxy workflow hasn't exactly been horrible until now, it was mainly just somewhat cumbersome with less options than I think many would have liked. You could, for example, only transcode proxies into ProRes proxy, and it would also always be at exactly half the original resolution, which, generally speaking, is fine, but if you had a lot or maybe very high resolution media you wanted to transcode, that still resulted in a lot of data, something you especially don't want if you need to exchange those files and libraries with somebody else over the internet, for example. Or, say you wanted to leave your original and or optimized media behind on an external disk or server, while taking just your proxy media with you locally in your Final Cut library on your MacBook Pro to edit on the go. Until now, that meant having to jump through a fair amount of hoops, especially because you could only consolidate all existing media at the same time and into the same location. And then you could only work in either original or proxy mode. So yeah, I think you can see there was room for improvement here. And that's what we've gotten with version 10.4.9. Let's look at the workflow in general first. For that, I have this project, which isn't huge, but it's still just over 140 gigs, which could already be too much for a MacBook, for example, that doesn't have a huge amount of internal storage. So let's assume the previously described scenario that I want to take this footage along with me locally in proxy while leaving the original media on an external disk or server at the office. If I select the library in the sidebar and click on the Modify Settings button for storage locations in the inspector, then we can see that the media, meaning all imported proxy and optimized files, are all copied to the library. As an aside, you may notice that now the Final Cut interface has been entirely dark-moded, meaning that this and various other windows used to be light-colored, no matter what mode the OS was set to. I'll cancel out of this, and normally I could of course simply choose to create the proxies upon import, but I didn't, so to generate them after the fact, I'll just go into my library and select everything with Command A, but before I transcode, I'll intentionally command-click this C008 clip that I know by the used media indicator at the bottom is being used in this project. That way I can show you a brilliant new option in Final Cut Pro in just a second. Now I can right-click on any one of them and choose transcode media.
And with that, the new and improved Transcode Media Options window opens. Here, next to the usual optimized media, which in this case I can't select since all my material is already in ProRes 422, I can still select to create proxy media. But once selected, we see what we came here for, namely the additional codec options I see listed below. Either the usual option to transcode to ProRes proxy, or now there's an additional option for H.264. But not only that, below that I even have an additional pop-up menu where I can select from a wide variety of scaling options. Since, as I just mentioned, up until now the only proxy files that could be created were not only highly compressed, but also exactly half the original frame size. But then they aren't anywhere near as highly compressed as H.264, since ProRes is an iframe-only codec with a 10 or even more bit color depth. So in any case, looking in the pop-up menu, we can see we now have the ability to actually create proxy files at their original 50, 25, or even 12.5% their original resolution. Below that, we also even have three up to resolutions that we can choose as a maximum, meaning that if I, for example, chose up to 1920 by 1080, anything above that is downscaled and anything at or below that resolution stays as it is. So also extremely helpful under certain circumstances. But there are still some limitations. To show which ones those are, I'll choose H.264 at 50% and click OK. And bingo. Since I in fact have one clip in this library that is HDR, I'm presented with a dialog box telling me that any and all high dynamic range media will in fact be transcoded to ProRes proxy, since H.264 only supports a color depth of up to 8-bit, meaning if it were transcoded to H.264 as well, it would lead to unwanted color shifts, and any color corrections applied would be completely off when switching back to the original media. I'll just click OK and let it render. In the meantime, just for general reference, I transcoded to the ProRes proxy at 50% resolution as well, as it's been up until now, as well as H.264 at 50% for comparison. Now keep in mind, as I showed you earlier, the original library with just the original media in it was 140 gigabytes. Now, for that same library, with just the ProRes proxy media consolidated to it, I ended up with a library of just under 8 gigabytes. With H.264, this same library was just 2 gigabytes with no real distinguishable difference in quality. In other words, we're talking about 25% the size of the usual proxies using H.264, and even the transcoding times were almost identical for both versions, coming in at around 14 minutes each for transcoding everything. So one doesn't even have to decide on whether size or time is the more important factor in a case like this. You could even create full-res H.264 proxies and still only have about half the amount of data to wrangle. Of course, depending on the material and your machine, your mileage may vary in terms of time and space. Once finished, I can now go into the view settings for the viewer, as one always has, to switch over to proxy. But you'll see that with 10.4.9, there are a couple of very interesting changes here. Namely, next to the usual optimized option, the proxy setting has changed to proxy only. And now there's also a proxy preferred option. So what is this for? Well, if you remember, I intentionally skipped one of my clips when I transcoded. Now, if I select Proxy Preferred, I have two advantages. One being that even though this one clip does not have a proxy file, it doesn't go offline. But that also means that if I switch to a project that doesn't have any proxies at all, then there too, nothing will go offline either. Because I don't know about you, but I personally found it rather annoying that I constantly had to switch back and forth depending on which project I was using and didn't want everything to go offline. In which case, I, in fact, even put in a request to have proxy settings on a per project basis and not globally. But this is actually a much better solution in my opinion. So if I go back to my view menu and select proxy only, I can see what I would have seen before this option, namely that one of my clips goes offline. So in other words, if I set this back to proxy preferred, then Final Cut will always use a clip's proxy media if it in fact exists. And if not, it'll default to the optimized or original media depending on what's available. This would also be brilliant, for example, in a scenario where you're having to mix easier to handle better performing media, such as ProRes or maybe H.264, with much harder to handle poorly performing footage, such as RED, Canon RAW, or something like 10-bit Panasonic material. all of which will struggle on most Macs, Red especially. But I should add that there are also new updates for both Red and Canon RAW, which I personally have not yet been able to test and am assuming have been optimized for the Metal framework. So even for them, proxies may have just become less necessary. We'll see. By the way, if you're either in proxy preferred or proxy only mode, and you select or just skim over any given clip in the library, and that clip has a proxy file, then you'll see a small proxy label above the viewer as well as at the top of the clip's information inspector window. This way, one can always quickly recognize if you may be looking at the potentially much lower quality version of the media. But getting back to our little workflow scenario of wanting to leave our original media behind and only take the now generated proxy media with us. What options do I have with 10.4.9? Well, as I explained before, if in previous versions you had already generated all your optimized and/or proxy media, it would all end up in the exact same place, namely whatever location you had defined in the storage location settings of the library. And separating them into different locations after the fact was quite the song and dance. This has all changed. Now, as opposed to earlier versions where clicking the consolidate button for the library would simply offer the options to consolidate optimized and proxy media according to the current settings, hitting the consolidate button for your media in 10.4.9 now opens an expanded dialog window with a couple additional, much more practical options. As opposed to only two options from the previous versions, you now not only have the option to also consolidate original media, but best of all, you can choose where to consolidate to from here. So if your library is currently set to copy your media to the library itself, you don't have to cancel out of here to go to the library settings and change it. You simply go into this pop-up menu at the top and choose whichever external destination you prefer. By the way, there's also a very handy new recent destinations menu item. So if you've previously consolidated any of your media to, say, an external server or folder that is still available, maybe one you use all the time, you'll have quick and easy access to that destination or destinations from here. I don't have any, so I'll just select choose and create a folder on my external disk and call it server. So we can pretend it's going to a server and select that. Back in our window with the options, I can now decide to include original, optimized, and/or proxy media individually. We can also see that with this, the default storage location for the library in general will also be changed to server after doing this. So for starters, I'll select original and optimized, even if in this case both are the same. I'll deselect proxy and click OK. Now everything of that media is copied to my quote-unquote server. Once that's done, just to make sure I'm not leaving any of my proxies behind, I'll click Consolidate again, set it back to my library, but this time only include the proxy media and click OK once again. And this happens. Because again, when I transcoded everything in my library, I intentionally left out one clip. Final Cut's new proxy management knows this, and I get this dialog window telling me that some of my media does not have a proxy version. If my transcode settings are set to H.264, then I am once again reminded that HDR clips will be transcoded into ProRes. This is, of course, brilliant, since I can now simply hit transcode and be sure that nothing actually goes offline once I disconnect from my original media. By the way, this will even pop up if you attempt to consolidate proxy or even optimize media and you don't actually have any at all of either, in which case some would mean none. Once the transcode is finished, I can quit Final Cut Pro and disconnect from my quote-unquote server by unmounting it. Now, if I restart Final Cut and load the same library, with the display mode set to proxy preferred, everything appears online. This, by the way, is also exactly what whomever I were to send this library to, this 2 GB-sized library, would see after opening it, without the need for access to originals or any relinking. But the brilliance of the new proxy workflow doesn't stop there, because there's a not-so-obvious additional change, something that I've been requesting for a while as well, because going through my timeline, you might notice that I have some graphics at the beginning and end, as well as some clips with animations that I made in motion in between, all with an alpha channel. The only thing is that up until now, after having been transcoded to ProRes Proxy, they would have lost their transparency since ProRes Proxy doesn't actually support alpha channels. But at the same time, H.264 doesn't either. So how could this be working? Well, if I switch between optimized original and proxy only, you'll see that with optimized only, the clips with alpha stay online. But with proxy, they do too. All the clips with alpha stay online, even though they couldn't possibly have regular proxies, as I explained. And again, with proxy preferred, everything appears online as well. So what's going on? It's because of a very smart new addition to the proxy workflow. Basically, Final Cut now recognizes media such as this, meaning graphics that support alpha, in this case a PNG, as well as clips in ProRes 4x4, which suggests that these two have or could have an alpha channel. But it also recognizes audio files that aren't transcoded, or rather don't need transcoding, such as WAV files. Since, again until now, other than maybe MP3 audio, these two would go offline if you lost the connection to the originals for lack of any proxy versions. Again, since Final Cut doesn't even transcode them to begin with, and never has. So how can I be seeing these if I'm not even connected to my original media at this point, and only consolidated proxies to my library? Well, because Final Cut recognizes that these files don't get their own proxies, therefore consolidates copies of the originals along with the other actual proxies. It essentially flags those originals as both original and proxy representations. In fact, it does that right from the get-go, before you even generate any proxies. Try it. Just switch any project with clips or images with an alpha channel or WAV files in it to proxy, and everything but that media will go offline. So no more tedious switching back and forth between display modes. But best of all, I don't have opaque clips that should actually be transparent. Something that could really ruin my day if it happened, and for which, in previous versions, there was no real fix. So this is really clever and a hugely welcome improvement. By the way, all the transcoding options that I showed you via right-click for transcoding media after importing it into the library are, of course, available in the import window for transcoding upon import as well. The options sidebar in the import window has also been cleaned up and optimized a bit as well. But matters still don't actually even stop there. There are two additional very cool improvements with the proxy workflow that are not quite as obvious. The first being that if I go to relink my media for the library via the file menu, I now have a new submenu with two options. I can relink my original media and my proxy media separately. The big news here is that that means Final Cut can now also link to proxies made using other tools, so I'm not limited to the proxy options built into Final Cut anymore. I can make any kind of proxies I like using another app or service and link to them using this new command. For example, I've used Kino to create 10-bit H.265 or HEVC proxies at 50% scale and can now simply choose Relink Files and then Proxy Media. Click Locate All. Navigate to the folder where I saved them. Click Choose. And I can see that all files have matched and just need to click Relink Files. And bingo. With that, I'm now working with the HEVC proxies. If I want to double check to make sure, I can use yet another new addition to the proxy workflow. Namely, I can right click any given clip. And I now not only have a reveal in Finder command as before, but also a separate reveal proxy media in Finder command. Selecting that takes me to the folder that I just chose. These, of course, take considerably longer to generate on pretty much any Mac. Namely, almost 2 hours for 720p versions and 5 hours for half-sized, so 2K versions on my MacBook Pro. Again, as opposed to the 14 minutes for the other proxies, but I'm saving even more space should that be something I need. In this case, up to an additional 50% depending on the material. I can even make proxies of my clips that have an alpha channel and even preserve the alpha since HEVC has that option. Unfortunately though, in this version at least, Final Cut Pro won't accept those files as a replacement. Even though they exist in the same folder, Final Cut will still stick to the original since, as I mentioned before, Final Cut has effectively already flagged these originals as proxy, so sees no need to replace them. something that isn't horrible and probably won't affect the vast majority of people, but it would be nice to have that as an option in the future. And yes, there's one more thing. Last but not least, Apple has made it possible to import proxy media generated by third-party applications via XML. In other words, you could use this to simply send any existing proxy media to Final Cut and link it to an event or project. For example, an onset DIT could use a service that transcodes new footage into proxies. That service could then generate the FCP XML that, along with the new proxies, could then be sent to the editor's library and be imported into the correct event. Later, the editor, after receiving the original source media, could then simply relink it separately for output. Pretty cool. Unfortunately, I don't know of any such app or service at the time of the making of this video, but I know that the makers of Kino, for example, are in the process of working this into a soon-to-be-released version, and I'm sure others will follow if they haven't already, depending on when you're watching this. And then there's the new copy-to-library command. With this, you could easily create a proxy-only copy of a library as well, but also use this to make an archival version of your library that only contains the media you want to keep, or for simply copying one library to another. To do this, I simply right-click the library I want to copy, and here, midway down, you'll find the new copy to library command. By the way, as you can see, you can also initiate the consolidate command just below it for both media and motion content, so one doesn't necessarily have to go to the library's information inspector. Going back to the copy to library command, we see that we get a flyout menu with options. At the top, I can choose to copy this library to any of the other currently open libraries. Selecting one opens the copy library window. Here I can choose what to include when copying. Whether I want to include the media and which of the three categories I want to include, be it original, optimized, and/or proxy. Under media destination, I'm automatically shown the destination that is currently set for the receiving library. So I can have the media either copied there, change it to the receiving library itself, or even choose an all-new location for what's about to be copied. For example, my wannabe server. I can also decide whether any media that may be stored outside of the library to be copied is also copied to the media destination I've chosen above, or is simply left where it is. And any changes I make also changes the storage location setting for the library that I'm copying to. Then I can also choose to copy the library without the media. Selecting this deactivates all the previous options below, since they've effectively become irrelevant. We're also told that using this option will have the clips appear as missing in the new library. I'll choose this and click OK. Back in the library sidebar, looking in the library that I chose to copy to, we can see the copied library's event or events have now been copied. And as we were told, selecting it shows all of the media as offline. At first, I actually had to think about when and how this could be useful. Then I thought, this is actually a nice option for when you want to exchange an entire library with somebody else that has copies of or access to the same footage, for example. So with this, you get the smallest possible library and simply need to reconnect the media at the other end. Something that I've in fact done many times before with colleagues I collaborate with that live in other countries. So this is something I've had to manually create, copy, etc. until now, but now it's only a few simple clicks away. Then there's one additional option that ties into both the exchange of libraries as I described, as well as an even simpler way of creating a proxy-only library. That's assuming that copying, and therefore effectively duplicating existing media, which means creating more data as opposed to just moving existing media, as I showed previously, isn't an issue or concern. Or, as I just mentioned, this could be used for creating a library with the least amount of data for archival purposes, for example. For all of the above, I just right-click the library again, return to the Copy Library submenu, and this time can select New Library at the bottom. With this, I'm first creating a new empty library for which I get a dialog box for naming it and selecting where to save it. I'll just name it DRV Archive and save it wherever I like. Then, just as before, select all the options I need. I can include original media for archival, or maybe redundancy, or just proxy media for the sake of size, for portability, or even just performance. By the way, This same window now also appears when simply dragging a library onto another, or even just dragging a project from one event to another. The latter meaning I'm only copying media used in that project, not the entire library. So this would be a perfect solution for anyone wanting to only archive the media that they actually used in any given project, leaving everything else behind. So yet another very cool and helpful addition to Final Cut's media management abilities. So anyone working in any of the social media spaces will really appreciate this next one and has probably been waiting for it for a while. Final Cut now has various project presets to suit various social media aspect ratios. To see which those are, I can simply hit Command N to create a new project and then click Use Custom Settings. Clicking the video pop-up menu shows me that below the usual 10 video preset categories, ranging from 1080 to 360 VR video, we now have two additional options, vertical and square. Selecting vertical, and then the resolution pop-up shows me that I now have vertical, HD, full HD, as well as UHD resolution project presets to choose from. Switching to the square format, we see that we have 720 and 1080 resolutions available, obviously with all the necessary frame rates as well. But again, there's more, because in conjunction with the new aspect ratios, Apple has added a brilliant new Smart Conform function. This feature is actually intended for any situations where the aspect ratio of the media and project don't match, and it automatically readjusts scale and even position as needed so that the media fits the new aspect ratio as best possible. And there are two ways of using Smart Conform. Let's take this project as an example, a short little commercial I made a while back. Scrubbing through it, we can see that there are various shots of this gentleman in his car, as well as this attractive young lady who eventually walks across the street. And in the end, there's her in the reflection of a window with this other gentleman. Now let's just assume I wanted to make a square version of this for social media. I could do this the hard way and the way one would have had to do it until now, and simply duplicate the existing project, for which I simply selected in my event and hit Command D. Select the copy and hit Command J to edit its settings. Here I'll select square and leave it at 720 by 720 and hit OK. Opening the duplicate and scrubbing through the timeline, I can see that the project is square, but all the clips are simply placed in the middle of the canvas, resulting in everything being very generously letterboxed. So, what can I do to get them to fill the viewer? Well, I can obviously go through each clip, scale it up, and reposition it as needed, but we now have Smart Conform for that. I can either select all the clips or just one, for example, this one with the girl waving, and then go into the Modify menu and here select the new Smart Conform. And after a short analysis, we can see that the clip hasn't just been scaled up, but also repositioned to fit the girl into the center of the frame. This is because Final Cut uses a variety of video analysis techniques, face detection, etc., to find areas of interest and then uses heuristics to set the transform appropriately. But let's look at a much easier way of doing this entire process. First, I'll delete my duplicate project. Now I can simply right-click my original project and can see here that I now have three options for duplicating. Next to the usual duplicate, and duplicate as snapshot, which is now simply called snapshot project, which I think is a smart move to reduce some confusion I've seen in the past, I now have an additional duplicate project as command. Selecting this takes me directly to the same dialog window when setting up a new project. Here I can rename my project with a square 720 at the end and go into the video format and select square. Now the key is to select the Smart Conform checkbox next to the video format that has now become active. This will always become active for any project I am duplicating where the aspect ratio is being changed. So if I were to go to 720 or 4K, for example, I would not have the option to Smart Conform since these two are 16:9 formats. 5K or vertical, on the other hand, would make it become active again. But I'll stick with square, activate the Smart Conform, and simply click OK. The dialog box closes, and Final Cut does a short analysis of all the clips in the timeline. But afterwards, I'm also presented a message showing me one of the small limitations while Smart Conforming. namely that clips that have a crop can't be conformed. I'll click OK, and if we look in the timeline, we'll see that the one clip with the young lady in it wasn't conformed, which is why it's centered in the viewer, because it in fact has a Ken Burns effect applied to it. But if we skim through the timeline, we can see all other clips were reframed using Smart Conform. And while something like this is, of course, never perfect, and will very much depend on the content of the clips to what degree they are optimally positioned after the conform, we can see that the clip towards the end, where we see her in the reflection, that Final Cut even managed to position the clip perfectly so that we can see both characters. So again, while probably not perfect in every situation, it's certainly at worst a huge help to get one started when conforming a project. Obviously, I can still go in at any time and to any clip to readjust it if needed. For example, this clip where we see the girl waving, we should actually also be able to see the man sitting in the car in the foreground. So I can go in and reposition it accordingly. And that actually leads me to the next very cool new feature in Final Cut Pro when it comes to transforming clips. A feature that motion users will be very familiar with, since Motion has had this option for as long as I can remember. To see it, I merely need to activate the transform controls, be it via the button at the bottom left, via a right click on the viewer by activating it in the inspector, or simply by hitting Shift-T. With that, we get the familiar transform controls and some buttons along the top of the viewer. But if we look closely, now, there's an additional button to the left of the reset button. If I scale my clip without it active, I'm only shown the clip content within the boundaries of the viewer, as it's always been. But if I reset that and activate the button and now scale and/or reposition my clip, we can see we're shown everything beyond the viewer boundaries in a semi-transparent representation. This is, of course, super helpful in a situation like this, for example, to judge how far I can go or if I can even go further, all the while seeing how much room I have to play with. Or even when animating something outside of the frame, for example, to not lose sight of it. Literally. And if I leave it active, zoom the viewer back a bit, and scrub my playhead through the project, I can even quickly and easily see how much of each individual clip was in fact cropped for it to be conformed. For example, we can see that the clip with the girl in the reflection was in fact moved to the right quite considerably to fit both into the frame, completely ignoring the guy on the right. Very nice. Oh, and to top it all off, if you check your titles browser and scroll to the bottom, you'll also find a new category called Social. Here you'll find a collection of 13 fairly basic titles that in fact also conform to whatever aspect ratio of the project you're using it in is set to, specifically if you're using it in one of the classic social media aspect ratios. So say, for example, I go back to my 16:9 project and connect the lower third news title from the social category to one of my videos, we can see the title in the far left corner. Now, if I go back to my square project and connect it here as well, if it didn't have these additional aspect ratios, or snapshots as they're called, embedded into it, then it would of course appear somewhere outside of the frame to the left. But as we can see, the title recognizes the square format and repositions itself appropriately so that it is correctly in frame. This is something you can easily set up in Motion when creating your title or template, or even after the fact should it not be displaying correctly. It's not actually a new feature. It's in fact been there since version 5.0, but it has been improved a bit. And if you're interested in knowing how to go about preparing your custom titles or templates so that they work in each aspect ratio, then stick around for the part where I talk about the new features and improvements in Motion. Sticking with the subject of aspect ratios, what if, for example, you haven't yet conformed your regular project to square and would just like to get a good idea of what things may look like after you conform and what the possible constraints will be space-wise? Well, that's where the all-new overlays come in. Clicking on the viewer's view menu shows us that in the overlays section next to the previously existing title and action safe as well as horizon overlays, we now have two new custom overlay menu items. Normally, selecting the first Show Custom Overlay menu point, you're able to turn any custom overlay you may have selected on and off. But right now, I can't, since I haven't actually yet chosen one to display. That is done with the second new menu item. Here in its submenu, we see the option to add a custom overlay. Selecting it opens a dialog box with which I can navigate to whatever image overlay I would like to use. I've actually put together a small collection of various overlays that I personally find very useful. On the one hand, various aspect ratio overlays ranging from square to super wide, as well as different types of grids and safe zone overlays. If anyone thinks that these could be helpful for them, I'll put a download link in the description. So let's just select the 1.0, in other words, square overlay. The window closes, and immediately I can see the black bars on each side covering my image, showing me the maximum area I'll be able to see should I choose to conform my project into a square aspect ratio. Going back to the Show Custom Overlay submenu, I can now choose to make the bars more or less transparent. The overlays are also global, meaning that even if I switch to a different project, that same overlay will still be visible. Unfortunately, they're always overlaid to fit the current frame, not fill. In other words, if I switch to my square project, we see the overlay scale down, which is unfortunate. Something that I've already put in a request for as well, alongside a request to overlay them with a different blend mode, which would make them better visible when overlaying the same color in the video image, such as a black line over a very dark video. So if I want to add even more overlays to choose from, I can simply repeat the procedure as before. Or if there are several I'd like to add all at the same time, I can go back into the Choose Custom Overlay submenu, and here at the bottom, select Reveal in Finder. After which Final Cut opens the folder in the Finder in which all the overlay images are saved. Now I can simply copy any image I'd like to use as an overlay into the folder. Back in Final Cut, I can see that I now have access to all of the images I just added. Another feature request for me is to have subfolders, since this can quickly get very full. Now I can, for example, select the overlay I put together, which contains all the various aspect ratios that might be relevant to me for reference, from a 1.9 to 1 all the way to a 9x16 viewing area. Another overlay I put together, for example, for when I'm in a vertical video, is an IGTV overlay, which shows me a worst case scenario when watching vertical videos on Instagram. So if I want to make sure that the most important parts of my video are always visible, even when all of the possible on-screen elements are active, I can use this as a reference, or even various grids, and so on. Of course, any and all of these are not rendered into the final movie, should I leave them active before exporting. In other words, if you need any of these burnt in, you'll need to import them as regular graphics. So, one of my personal favorites amongst the new features. Next up, a nice little improvement for those of us working with ProRes RAW, as well as those people that somehow think that without a metadata panel for changing attributes such as ISO or color temperature, a RAW format isn't actually RAW. Something many have claimed up until now, that due to the lack of these controls, ProRes RAW wasn't RAW. Well, that, of course, is complete nonsense, since it's most certainly RAW, as opposed to some other formats out there that call themselves RAW. Not to mention that you could, of course, just as much change a clip's exposure and color temperature without any such metadata panel. But then, all that is now irrelevant, since this functionality has been added. With Final Cut 10.4.9, you merely have to select your ProRes RAW media in the browser or in the timeline. Head over to the Information Inspector. Look that you have it set to the clip's settings window with the pop-up menu at the bottom left. And here, below the settings for the RAW to log conversion and camera LUT pop-ups, where, by the way, new LUTs have been added for Nikon, you'll now see information for the clip's ISO with a pop-up below it with which you can change it to a long list of other values. Below that, you have a slider to change the exposure offset to anything between -1 and +1. And last but not least, a color temperature value. In my case, I'm unable to change the color temperature because these clips were recorded with a recorder with an older firmware version, which did not yet include all the now needed information in the metadata. Therefore, I can't change it in this particular instance. So be sure to look out for firmware and software updates for cameras and recorders to be sure that you're getting this information recorded to the files. But either way, ProRes RAW is still the only compressed and truly raw codec aside from maybe Red RAW. So there's that. So moving from a couple of very cool video-related improvements, let's look at an improvement that's not only audio-related, but again something I think a lot of people have been waiting for a while. And that's audio-only crossfades. Yes, something that oddly wasn't possible, or rather not very easy to do up until now, is just a simple menu command or keyboard shortcut away. I of course emphasize the fact that they are crossfades, since there have in fact been simple fades for a few versions now that could be applied by a menu command or shortcut, assuming you actually assigned one. A function that I personally have been totally content with, since I don't remember the last time I needed an audio-only crossfade, rather than just a short fade for the sake of avoiding potential pops on edits. The good old zero crossing issue, something I'm sure everyone has experienced at some point or another. So how does this work? For starters, we'll open the preference window by hitting Command Comma, and here under the editing panel, we'll see next to the familiar settings for the audio fades, still images and transitions, a new crossfade setting. As you can see, I've set my audio fades to a very short 0.1 seconds, since I use this, as I've said, as a safety precaution to avoid any potential pops between edits. I've also assigned a shortcut to it in the Modify menu and Adjust Audio Fades submenu. I've assigned option A via the command editor so that when I, for example, select these two clips and expand their audio with Control S so we can see it better, that currently don't have any changes made to their fade handles, as I can see if I mouse over the audio, I simply need to hit option A and the very short audio fades have been applied. Short enough to be unnoticeable, but long enough to avoid any possible pops. But other than that, nothing else has changed about the clips. I'll undo that. The new crossfades are normally set to 0.1 seconds by default also, so I could technically use them instead from now on, but I've set them to a duration of 1 second just so we can see better what happens. I can close the preference window, and if we look into the Modify menu once again and the Apply Fades submenu, we can see there's a new crossfades command that has the shortcut Option T. So with the two clips still selected, I can now just hit Option T. And as we can see, the audio of each clip is automatically extended. And if I mouse over each clip's audio, I can see there's a fade applied via the fade handles as well. Of course, in this case, an actual extension of the audio only led to additional audio being introduced that I don't actually want. So it's really a question of a case-by-case need and which makes the most sense. But either way, we now have the additional option, which is always a good thing, and I'm sure a lot of people will be very happy about this. I may even start using it instead from now on. Speaking of which, this is another one that I'd love to hear from people that have been looking for this functionality. That functionality being the new pop-up menu above the timeline. While we've had these two arrows to cycle through the timeline history, and we're even able to click and hold to see a list of any technically open timelines, that was really about it. Now in the middle between project name and length, there's an additional pop-up. Clicking on it reveals that with this, we now have quick and easy access to some useful commands. The first one being the duplicate command or command D. In other words, we can both select this in the menu or simply hit command D when the project is active to duplicate it. Below that, we now have the ability to have Final Cut show us the current project in the browser, as there has always been for media in the timeline. Where the shortcut for revealing media in the browser is Shift F, we now have an option Shift F for projects. This is actually something I have been wanting to be able to do, especially when I'm working with endless revisions. Below that, there's easy access to the project's settings or command J. This not being new, just a little easier to access. Selecting it as hitting command J before opens the project's information window where I can once again click the modify button to change its settings if I need to. Something I personally don't think I've ever missed, but I've heard from others that have, are the last two items. The first being the ability to close the current project, and the last the option to close any other projects that may be open. So, looking into the timeline history, either on the left or right, by clicking and holding the arrow, I can see there are a few other projects open. Selecting the last menu item and rechecking the timeline history shows me that everything else has in fact been closed. So, is this something that you wish you could have done before now? Let me know down in the comments. This next one is another improvement that doesn't concern me personally all that much either, but I know a lot of people will be very thankful for it having been added. Since up until now, if you were someone working in the area of 360-degree VR video, you might have been missing a few useful options regarding stereoscopic VR in Final Cut Pro X. Monoscopic VR being the classic equirectangular video, only made up of a single view, such as those that you can make with an Insta360 camera, for example. But if you have a camera that records stereoscopic images or videos, while you've been able to use Final Cut to edit the footage in general since version 10.4, again, it was lacking some useful options. If I hit Command N to create a new project, and look in the custom settings under video and select 360 degrees, I can select the stereoscopic preset and now also have resolutions of up to 8K UHD. Or to simply have Final Cut auto-recognize my footage, I can just go back to the automatic settings, give the project a name, well, just call it Stereo, and click OK. Now I can select my stereoscopic VR clips and hit the E key to append them to the timeline. With that, I now see my stereoscopic clip, as always, displayed in the over-under mode. And if I look above my viewer, I also see that it's been correctly identified as 360-degree video stereo 3D and 8K UHD. Now, with Option Command 7, I can open the 360-degree viewer and look around in my scene. By default, I'm looking at the left eye view, which has been the only view that one had available. Until now, because if I go into the settings menu above the VR viewer, I see a new stereoscopic section at the bottom of the menu. And here I can set it to any of the 7 other new stereoscopic viewing options. I can switch to the right eye, or maybe the classic red-green anaglyph mode, all the way to a difference mode, which places the images over each other with a difference blend mode. By the way, you can now also stabilize VR clips with a single click in the inspector. So we can see that anyone working with stereoscopic video or images should be able to find everything they need to edit them in Final Cut Pro now. If you're someone working in the VR space, I'm always curious to hear what you think and if you feel something could still be improved. Again, let us know down in the comments. Moving on to Motion, the only other app that can compete with my utter fandom for Final Cut Pro X, even though it traditionally hasn't seen quite as much love from Apple as most users would like, including this time around, but I'll take what I can get. So what's happened? Well, 3D. Apple has decided to expand Motion's 3D capabilities considerably, at least in terms of what it can import. As of 5.4.6, Apple has given us the ability to import USDZ files. What files, you say? USDZ. USDZ stands for Universal Scene Description. It's a 3D exchange file format introduced by Apple in collaboration with none other than Pixar, and is primarily meant for use in the context of ARKit, Apple's augmented reality framework. A format that is in fact supported on iOS, macOS, and even tvOS. And while some of the most experienced 3D artists may not know much, if anything, about it, it's actually quite a brilliant format in comparison to some of the better known and more common formats such as OBJ, FBX, or the likes. Because while Pixar initially developed the format, Apple came along and added a Z, as in zipped, to it, which means it's a single file that contains everything you need from animation information to all the various textures, bump maps, etc. that you might need to properly render the scene. In other words, unlike so many other 3D exchange formats such as Wavefront's OBJ, for example, you don't have to deal with a folder full of endless models and texture files, but rather just one simple file that contains everything. Again, even any animation that may have been applied. For anyone interested in diving deeper into the USDZ format, I'll post some helpful links for you in the description, such as one to Pixar, to Apple's WWDC workshop on USD, and more. So let's jump into Motion and see what this is all about. I've just opened a simple project, and if we look into the Library tab, you'll see there's a new category, 3D Objects. And here you'll find over 50 models divided into 8 topics from education to transportation. So there's no more messing around with fonts, the only actual 3D objects up until now, to twist them into looking like something you might need as an object and trying to animate them. As with anything else in Motion's library, I simply drag them from here onto my canvas or click the Apply button at the top of the inspector to place them perfectly centered into the canvas. The vast majority of the standard models are static, but you will find the occasional animated model here and there, since, as I explained before, USDZ files can maintain any animation exported with the file. For example, the helicopter under the transportation theme. Simply placing it into my canvas and hitting the play button shows the animation. And what's especially cool is that Motion will recognize if a model is animated and automatically set its timing end condition parameter to loop. Which means I simply import it and can extend it to whatever length I need, and it will automatically loop perfectly, as you can see by these little notches in the layers bar, which represent the loop points. But obviously, I can animate any inanimate objects as well. For example, I simply used the Earth and the Moon from the 3D Education theme, the Starfield particle system, and just a couple of behaviors to create this fully 3D orbiting animation, which I'm pretty sure is scientifically incorrect in every possible way. And since this is 3D, I can use my camera to view the scene from any angle that I like. These objects also interact with Motion's lights, as everything else does that is in 3D space. So I can, for example, reset my camera with a double click, add a light, make it directional, move it over to the left, even if the position of a directional light is completely irrelevant, but this way we can see it, and rotate it by minus 90 degrees on the y-axis to simulate something along the lines of a sun. I can even give it a bit of a yellow tinge if I'd like, and adjust the intensity as needed. But then you might wonder why I can still see so much of the models even though I only have a singular light coming from the left. That doesn't actually help the realism when the opposite sides of my planets are still so bright. Well, that's because the entire scene has a default environment light, essentially the same as Motion's own ambient lights, which emits light in all directions, illuminating all objects in the scene from all directions equally. So basically to add an overall fill effect. To access its settings, I simply need to select the project layer, look in the inspector under the Properties tab, and here towards the bottom, under Rendering, we see a new 3D Object Environment slider, which, by the way, is only relevant for 3D objects, not 3D text. Now, as I decrease the amount from the default 100%, we can see how the right sides of my planets begin to become increasingly darker. If I set this to 0, then only my actual scene lights, in this case my one directional light, become the only source of light for the scene. And again, I can simply hit play and use my camera controls to find the perfect angle. Of course, with the usual real-time performance at the full 25 frames per second of my project. And obviously, one can use the new 3D objects as part of any template, title, effect, etc. for use in Final Cut Pro as with any other media. For example, here I just threw together a very simple scoreboard style title where the bar in the background is just a scaled cube from the library, and I placed some of the various balls available in the sports category in the middle, again with some simple behaviors to animate everything. I even rigged all the balls into a pop-up menu, so if I switch to Final Cut and use this in my project, you can see that in the inspector, I can switch to whatever ball, or rather sport, I happen to need at that moment. So I think this will spawn an awful lot of new ideas and templates and prove to be a great new option and addition to have, even though, yes, I'm sure this may not be the first feature that came to many people's minds when they were thinking of what could be new for Motion. But again, I'd say this is the basis for some very cool stuff in the future. Of course, you might be asking yourself, where do I get content? Can I even get any content, or can I create my own if I want, since just over 50 models isn't exactly a huge pool of material to work with? Or maybe you already have a big library of OBJ or GLTF models and would like to use those. Well, as far as sources for material are concerned, there are sites such as usdzshare.com. And I would highly recommend checking out sketchfab.com because as of March 2020, every single downloadable model on Sketchfab, which works out to over 400,000 models, is now available in the USDZ format. This includes both free Creative Commons licensed models, of which there are a lot, by the way, as well as royalty-free models on the Sketchfab store. And as I've mentioned before, if they contain any animation, then that too is retained in the file. All you have to do is click the download link for any given file and select USDZ. Once downloaded, you can even preview USDZ files in the Finder with the spacebar, or rather with the Finder's Quick Look feature, as you can with OBJ files as well, by the way. Then simply drag the file directly into your canvas, extend if needed, and hit play. So I think you can see that this will open a whole new world of possibilities for creating amazing titles, templates, and more without the need for any sort of plugin for distributing them to other users. But as with so many wonderful things in life, there are, of course, a few caveats and limitations to keep in mind. The biggest one for me being that these 3D models, much like the 3D titles that we are so very familiar with, unfortunately live in their own 3D space. In other words, the same way that 3D titles can't intersect or interact with 2D layers and elements, in a project, the 3D models you import can't occupy the same space as the 2D layers, nor 3D text objects. So if I add a 2D plane and a 3D text to my scene and position the camera so that we can see their positions in relation to each other, you'll see that while pushing either through the 3D model, they never actually intersect with it, nor do they with each other. Another unfortunate detail, again similar to 3D text, is that 3D models also don't cast shadows. Unlike 3D text, which can at least cast shadows on other 3D text objects, 3D models don't cast shadows at all. So this scene, for example, that I put together just for giggles, that has a particle generator made of robots, which, by the way, actually plays at its full frame rate as well without rendering, of course, loses a bit of realism since the robots don't cast a shadow on the ground nor on each other. But then horses for courses, since Motion isn't a 3D app, nor is it intended to replace one. There are several options out there as far as that's concerned, if that's something one needs. Be it you, for example, get MO2 from Motion VFX for internal 3D functionality, or even an app such as Blender, which is very powerful and even free for external 3D work that you can then import. Because Blender can, in fact, already export USD files, and there is even a free plugin to enable the direct import and export of USDZ files. Though my first few unscientific tests seem to show that animations appear to be lost upon import, so there might be some limitations, or it's simply user error, I don't know. And if you're already using some other 3D package, for example, Rhino, Maya, 3ds Max, or Fusion, then you can head over to simlabsoft.com where you can download specific plugins for those and other apps to enable USDZ export for them, or even get the SimLab Composer itself, which looks pretty cool and can also export directly to USDZ. And then there are even a couple of possibilities from Apple themselves. If you're looking to create simple scenes, for example, you can use the free Reality Composer. Here you even have some fun physics and animation options to play with. And best of all, there's a pretty huge library of models that you can use. Even things such as different callout bubbles, furniture, and even entire houses and clocks that are surprisingly customizable. And when you're finished and you've enabled USDZ export in the preferences, you again just output whatever you have and simply drag the resulting file into Motion. And last but not least, For those that may already have Wavefront OBJ GLTF or USDZ files, as I mentioned, that you'd like to use, you can also download Apple's free Reality Converter, for example, that is currently in beta. With this, you simply drag your file into the window, and after it thinks about it for a little bit, you see your model. You can even edit materials if you like, and then simply export once again as a USDZ file. Though my experience has been that it doesn't currently do too well with some OBJ files. But GLTF files seem to work very well. So again, I think you can see that this has the potential to add a lot of production value to your motion projects, and with that, to Final Cut projects as well. I'm very curious to see what people do with this, especially commercially. And if anyone comes up with something very cool they'd like to share, please leave a link in the comments. I'd love to see it. And of course, I'll post all the relevant links to the various apps and resources I've been talking about in the description as well. And if you know of any other options that I haven't mentioned that you think people should know about, then post those in the comments. I too would love to know what else there might be. Now, remember when I was talking about the new social titles in Final Cut Pro and their ability to recognize and auto-adjust to a project's aspect ratio changes? I said that there was something new in Motion. Well, technically, this isn't actually new. It's always been there. Apple has merely improved the feature a bit to make it easier to use. And while nearly all standard Final Cut titles, transitions, effects, etc. have been edited to work in various aspect ratios, any custom titles, templates, etc. that you might have that don't have so-called snapshots set up for the needed aspect ratios will need to have them added to work correctly in, for example, this square project. For example, if I skim my scoreboard title that I showed you earlier, we see that it's previewed in 16:9, as any title is, in which case it looks perfectly fine. Now, if I connect an instance to each clip in my square project, we can see the world isn't so perfect anymore. I can add some random values, switch the sport accordingly, but the title has basically just been placed centered over my video and hasn't even been scaled to fit. Therefore, it's cropped on either side, and the text fields for the team names are outside of the frame. And even scaling it down doesn't work, since that also scales the video below it, as titles will sometimes do because of the title background layer. But if you have Motion, and I highly recommend everyone have it in their arsenal, especially since it's only a measly $50, this is actually a very easy fix. Even for someone that has never done anything with Motion before because they find it to be very intimidating. Because all I need to do is right-click on the title in my titles browser and select Open in Motion. By the way, if this were one of the standard Final Cut titles, it would say Open a Copy in Motion. With that, surprise, surprise, the title is opened in Motion. And now all I have to do is select the project layer at the very top of my layers window, switch to the inspector window, and then select the project tab. And here I have two sub-tabs, publishing and snapshots. Clicking on snapshots shows me which display aspect ratios have been set up for the project. And we can see I only have one for 16:9. In other words, the ones listed here are which aspect ratios are recognized and adjusted for when used in Final Cut Pro. Again, this is nothing new, but rather something that has been a feature since version 5.0. But what is new is the simplicity of setting these up. As of version 5.46, you just click on the plus button and are given a simple pop-up menu with the most common aspect ratios to choose from. So anything from 1.8 to 1 to 9:16, and I still have the option to enter any custom aspect ratio at the bottom. So to make this title work in my square project, I simply choose the 1:1 display aspect ratio preset. With that, it's added to my list of snapshots, and if I select it, my canvas instantly adjusts accordingly, and we see what we saw in Final Cut. My title bar is cropped on either side. Now, all I have to do is scale and position everything as I would like it to appear should it ever be used in a square aspect ratio. So with my new aspect ratio selected, I first just need to click edit snapshot to let Motion know that the changes I'm about to make only pertain to this snapshot. A little window opens with a button to stop the edit mode, and with that I simply select the text and balls layers, hit F1 to go into the Properties tab, and enter a scale of, let's say, 55%. Looks good. Now all I have to do is click and drag the layers while holding the Shift key to constrain the movement vertically to position them at the lower end of the frame where they belong. I can even slightly reposition the balls a little bit higher up to compensate for the slight change of perspective, since this is 3D after all. And I'm done. After clicking the Stop Rig Edit Mode button, I can switch between the two aspect ratio snapshots to check that everything is as I wanted. Of course, I could do the same for a 9:16 aspect ratio, for example, if I needed it, but I'll leave it at that for now, close the project, and of course, save. Now, back in Final Cut Pro, the new version is in my titles browser, but the instance in my timeline is still of the old version, which is why nothing has changed. But as a little power user tip, all I have to do is select the old version in my timeline and double-click the new version in my browser. And with that, the old is replaced with the new, and as we can see, it fits perfectly with how I had imagined it, and even the previously entered values have been preserved. And that's about everything you need to know about the new display aspect ratio functionality. But if I did in fact forget something, again, let me know down in the comments. And last but not least, there is a new stroke effects filter in Motion. This filter can be used to automatically create a gradient or solid color outline around the edges of a keyed subject, shape, or text object. So basically, add an outline to anything with an alpha channel. Here I have a simple project with two people passing a key in front of a green screen that I shot for a client. And I've applied a custom LUT for a bit of color correction, and of course a keyer. The concept of the stroke filter is pretty simple, and I would imagine fairly self-explanatory. If I play the clip and maybe stop it somewhere in the middle, I just need to select the video layer, go into the filters menu, and here under the border category, we find the new stroke filter that I can apply by simply selecting it. And immediately we see the effects. I get a thin outline around my subjects in the default color of red. In the inspector under filters, I can see all the various parameters that I'm able to customize. First and foremost, I can decide on how the color of the outline is applied with the stroke type menu. To be able to see this a little better, I'll just increase the width to about 50 or 60. Now, if I go back to the stroke type and select gradient, we can see the chosen gradient color is applied to the stroke from the top to the bottom of the image. I can, of course, choose any of the many other gradient presets, or even create my own, whereby the classic gradient control elements become active in the canvas, with which I can change angle and spread. With the position settings, I can decide whether I want the stroke to run along the outside of my alpha, centered, or even the inside, each time creating a new effect. If I set this to outside and then adjust the offset slider, we can see that changes the relative distance to the subject. So I can, for example, make the outline float around my image. The threshold decides to what degree the outline follows the detail of the alpha channel. So in a sense, the softness, a very high value, for example, tightens it along the alpha, introducing some noise. With the two fade sliders, I can adjust the inside and outside softness of the outline, as well as use the fade width and fall off to further fine-tune the look of my stroke. Hiding the source is one of the more interesting options. Activating this hides the original source, only showing the stroke. So if I, for example, wanted to make this outline a little more dynamic, I could duplicate this layer, delete or deactivate the stroke from the lower layer, and set the stroke filter of the upper layer to hide the source. Then apply a distortion filter to the upper layer, such as the underwater filter. Adjust the settings to my liking, and then maybe even apply a glint filter to accentuate it all a bit. And with that, I get a nice and cheesy 80s-style music video effect. And that pretty much does it for Motion. So lastly, let's turn our attention to Compressor. And while Compressor has once again seen the least amount of new features, they're still not exactly insignificant, and once again prove that the belief that Apple somehow doesn't care about professionals is still complete nonsense. Because especially Compressor now has several new features that will be primarily, if not exclusively, of great relevance to professionals. To start things off, should you, for example, use Compressor to optimize or transcode your ProRes RAW footage before ingesting it into Final Cut Pro, you now have the option to set a RAW to log conversion and or the option to convert log encoded video to SDR or HDR color spaces using either one of the standard camera LUTs from the inspector or even importing one of your own. But you can also apply a third-party LUT to video files using the new custom LUT effect. And then there's the new IMF creation. Yes, now you too can create those self-destructing audio and video clips for the Impossible Missions Force. Yeah, well, maybe not. Okay, IMF, in the context of Final Cut Pro and Compressor, stands for the SMPTE Standard Interoperable Master Format. IMF is effectively the successor to the Digital Cinema Package Architecture, or DCP, something anyone that has ever had to deliver their work for a movie theater, for example, will be very familiar with. Only that IMF provides a complete and single file interchange unit for a distribution channel and is now easily created with Compressor. And while this may not mean much to many people, the fact that Final Cut, or rather Compressor, now supports the creation of IMF files, I'd say is actually a pretty big deal for the aforementioned professionals. So, how's it done? Well, in usual Apple manner, very easily. With the project, with all its video, audio, and even various subtitles that you'd like to export as IMF selected in Final Cut Pro, you simply go to the File menu to Send to Compressor, and then New IMF Package. And with that, Compressor opens with a new untitled IMF package in the batch list. The three audio roles I had in my project are listed individually, and I can select them to assign various metadata, such as name, languages, as well as use the inspector for things such as field order or camera log if needed, and then simply start the batch. And if you've already output your various media stems individually, you can also manually put your IMF package together by selecting New IMF Package from the File menu and populate this with the needed metadata. And aside from a couple of other changes that we won't be talking about here, we now also have the same options to encode proxy media as ProRes or H.264 here, as we do in Final Cut, in a new proxy settings group. Including these options here give you the ability to have even more flexibility in the proxies you create. You can set up a preset to burn in timecode, add custom LUTs, etc., etc., as well as have more control over where you want the files to go. Or even create a droplet of your desired preset for quick and easy drag and drop encoding from the desktop, for example. Additionally, you could use Compressor to leverage distributed processing for large 8K files, for example, or assign actions to take place after a batch has been completed. And you can, of course, customize any preset to use any other codec for your proxies, such as these that I put together that use both 8 and 10-bit HEVC as the output format, with and without alpha channels. I simply use these to render out my files and then go to Final Cut to relink them as my proxies, as you saw me do in the earlier part of this video. And lastly, for those of you already using Compressor for distributed processing, you'll probably be very happy to know that it now uses SMB as its protocol for improved reliability and performance. So altogether, in the end, not bad for a supposedly small incremental update.
Whew. Okay, and that's it from me. There are, of course, other features in the update which I have not shown here in detail, but simply want to mention for the sake of completeness, those being changes to FX Plug, Final Cut's plugin framework, and to FCP XML, now version 1.9, new so-called encoder extensions, the fact that Compressor can now decode PNG films, which I never even knew existed until now, and improvements in the context of media asset management systems. I'm sure that others here on YouTube will go to the trouble of covering those topics for those interested. And something I don't want to miss out on, I would also really like to thank you all. Everyone who helped push this channel over the perhaps small but still very encouraging milestone of 5,000 subscribers. It is great to see that the many hours of work that go into these tutorials are appreciated by so many. So thank you very much for that. And if these videos were of value to you, again, I'd much appreciate the thumbs up and maybe a subscription. And if not, there's always the thumbs down, in which case I'd love to hear what you didn't like or maybe were missing down in the comments. Thank you so much for sticking around for so long, and I hope to see you again in the next video. Take care, stay safe and healthy. Here, in the info card, and that's my doorbell. Bye.